Psalms number 19. We may get over to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, but because of the hour and everything, let me borrow your pen for 1 minute there. Psalms 19. Amen? Amen. And if I were to put a message, I would say part two, only Jesus can satisfy. Look at somebody and touch them by the hand and say, only Jesus can satisfy. You believe that this morning? You believe that? Say it again. Only Jesus can satisfy. Amen. No. Praise God. Amen. You tried everything else and it fell through. You tried that and it didn't work. But only Christ, when he came through, could he satisfy you. Ain't that right? You tried this thing and that didn't work. You tried that thing and that didn't work. You went over here and them folks didn't work. You went over there and those folks didn't work. But when you finally realize who Jesus is and what he's able to do, you realize that he was able to make you content. That's what the word define, satisfy, mean to be content, to be comfort, to be elated, to be pleased, to be delighted. Are y'all talking to me this morning? To make merry, to be cheerful, to be gratified. The word satisfy means to be content or fulfilled. The word satisfied means to be accomplished or complete. And the word satisfied means be provided for. Amen. We all like to be provided for, amen? Amen? I remember coming up, and I always thought, I ain't going to grow up. Oh, y'all don't want to hear me talk. Because I had it good in the neighborhood. Having fun and playing all day and swinging and picking blackberries and, you know, picking nuts out of the trees and going down to the corner store, get me a cold piece of cheese with some crackers and sit in the tree. And I just figured I'm going to be like this the rest of my life. But then I met responsibility. Oh, y'all don't want to hear me talk. Responsibility started eyeballing me. Let me know you can't be like this always. It ain't going to last for so long. So you see, God is good anyhow. Y'all might not understand where I'm coming from, but God is good both day and night, even in the midnight hour. Even when things weren't going right, I can still give God the praise. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. What a loving God we serve. Even in the midst of my hard-headedness, God was right there. Even when things didn't turn out right, God was right there. Even when others frowned on me and sucked their teeth, God was right there. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. Then I realized that at that age, didn't quite know him like I know him now, but he knew me. Oh, my God. And I realize only Jesus can satisfy. Come on, somebody. There's a song, only Jesus. Come on, somebody. Can satisfy. Ain't that right? Oh, my God. So if you're in Psalm 19, just say amen. Amen. Praise God for the victory. Amen. You see, David, who was a chief musician, he was multi-talented. Come on, somebody. With all his gifts and talent, he made sure that God got a piece of the action. Oh, y'all don't want to hear me talk this morning. You see, he understood that he's tried many things in his young life. He's slain bears. Oh, come on, somebody. He's slain lions. You know this because in Psalm 23, he tells you, though I walk through the valley of the shadow. You see, one moonlit night while he was watching the sheep, he must have caught a glimpse or he must have caught a shadow of a bear, of a lion. So he spotted this lion's shadow or this bear shadow. He said, yeah, you know, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Sometimes death casts a long shadow. But you need not fear because you got Jesus who can satisfy. Even when death come down your street, even when death knock on your back door, you can tell death, I hear you knocking. I hear you knocking. Ain't no room for you to come in. God didn't call you unto death, but he called you unto life. Oh, my God. But you see, David learned some very interesting things, so he wanted to share with you and me. Not knowing the impact of his words will impact us today, but surely it does. You know this psalm by heart. Many have read and studied, but he says, the heavens that God created declare the glory of God. You can't look around and tell that God made this. Man didn't do it. Oh, I know man coming up with 0.1 and 0.2, what they call singularity. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about where a computer make another computer and going to challenge mankind. You see, this is where we're heading in the direction. It's all about the Antichrist. And Big Brother has always been watching, and if he were watching before, he's going to continue to watch even more. So you're going to have to get over the fact that somebody's taking your picture. Come on, somebody. Because your picture being taken anywhere between 15 and 20 times in the course of one day. Even while you're sitting up in this room, the camera got you already. Amen. Come on, somebody. So you see, they can tell you where you've been during the course of the day, even though you don't want to tell nobody. Uh-huh. The heavens and the earth declare the glory of God. And the firmament itself shows forth this handiwork. Come on, somebody. God spoke something and the Holy Ghost went out and made it. God spoke something and the Spirit hovered over it and created what God spoke it. And his created power come from the mind and the soul of God. Verse 2 says, day unto day I utter speech. I have prayer and talk, and at night unto night I show forth, I bring forth, our knowledge has been revealed. Every day you're growing in the body of Christ. The more you read the word, the more you come to be familiar with it. The more you begin to be able to quote it and memorize it. The more you be able to fight the enemy when he comes down your way. He says, there is no speech. Listen, verse 3 says, there is no speech and there is no language where the Lord, the voice of the Lord cannot know or cannot hear or cannot understand. You know how many different dialects of languages and languages there are?
That's true.
And God understands them all.
Yes,
you have people that can speak 12, 13 different languages?
Amen.
That's impressive. Amen. But that don't impress God because he can speak them all. God can speak them all. You have to thank God whatever tongue you're speaking in, God can understand. Even the language of tears. Tell Hezekiah, I heard his prayer. But what got to God wasn't really the prayer. It was the tears that flowed from the soul. That God said, I understand that language because I know what's in the heart of man and I know what he needs and only God can satisfy. Oh, that's the kind of message that makes me want to get up on my toes. And, like I'm on a diving board. I might do a swan today. Come on, somebody. You see, it's important that you understand that he says in verse 4, there is a line. There is a line that's going out through all the earth. In other words, a measuring line. It went out through all the earth and the words to the end of the world. This will be proclaimed. God's words are like a line that goes throughout the whole world. In them have he set a tabernacle for the sun. Isn't that wonderful? You got a tabernacle you're living in right now.
Amen.
But when this tabernacle is all over with, only Jesus can satisfy.
Amen.
You see, this old tabernacle one day going to be resolved.
Oh, yes, it is.
This tabernacle you're living in is going to be resolved.
Amen.
But in verse 5, he said, which is as a bridegroom cometh out of the chamber.
Amen.
And rejoice as a strong man to run a race.
Amen.
See, any man don't just get in and run the race. He got to make preparation.
That's right.
Come on, somebody. I know many of y'all, every year, they run the Boston Marathon. Some of y'all said, I might run. But I'm going to run to the store and get me something cold to drink and something cold to eat. Because I ain't running the Boston Marathon. You got to be prepared. Some people run. Most people, they get out there. They look like they're going to make it. And oh, about the 10th mile. And then when they hit Heartbreak Hill, oh, their heart begin to break and the pace begin to slow. Come on, somebody. Sometimes you see them older folks out there, 75, 80, 85. Come on, somebody. Then you see folks, they're tired of running, now they're walking. And I love those people. They got in their mind, I might not be able to run across, but I'm going to crawl across. He that endured to the end. Hey, 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 if you're in the race, come on, somebody, then set the pace. Set the pace to finish the race. And ain't he that, come on, somebody, that gets in the race, and he that endured to the end, the same shall be saved. Why is that? Because only Jesus can satisfy. His going forth is from the ends of the earth, and his circular unto the ends of it. And there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. You see that? Verse 6. 7 says, the law of the Lord. The law of the Lord is perfect. Converting, changing, restoring the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure. Making wise those that are simple. Verse 8 says, the statutes of the Lord are right. Everybody said, the statutes of the Lord are right. Now let me get you something straight here. We know what a statue out on the Boston Common looked like. It's man-made with hands. But the statue of the word of God is made by the mouth of God. And if we keep the statue of God's word like the statue on the Boston Common before us, we know who we're going to represent. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. Amen. It's important that the statutes of the Lord are right. Rejoice in the heart. Amen. When you're right, you're right. Amen. Come on, somebody. Amen. The commandments of the Lord is pure. Amen. And it enlightens the eyes. Amen. It will enlighten you because it's just right. Amen. Ain't nothing wrong with God. Amen. Everything is right. Amen. Somebody say, ain't nothing wrong with God. Everything is right. The fear of the Lord is clean. The fear of the Lord, the honor of the Lord is clean. It endures forever. The judgment of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. To more to be desired, the statute and the judgment of God are more to be desired than gold, yet much more than fine gold. It's sweeter than honey. And the honeycomb. If you ain't had pure honey, then you missing out on something real sweet. Oh, y'all ain't with me. Sometimes, you know, sugar can't satisfy you. Come on, somebody. Milk can't satisfy you. Sugar has got something unique about it that God allow the bees to pollinate, bring back to the hide. And you and I every now and then can buy a jar that's been scooped out of the bee's nest. Not only with the honey, but with the honeycomb. And the word of God is sweeter. Oh, my God. I said the word of God is sweeter than the honey in the honeycomb. Oh, my Lord. Moreover, by them is a servant warned. The word of God tells us we've been warned. Not once, not twice. But God warns us all the time. And keeping in them, there is a great reward. Don't you know that integrity intact will cause prosperity? Everybody say integrity. Intact will cause prosperity. You're going to get it in your thought in a minute. Who can understand God's error? I don't know. If God made a mistake, Junior, I wouldn't know it. I wouldn't know it. You tell me when God made a mistake. You know, people want to always get you wrong. And if they're going to get you wrong, they're going to try to get God wrong. But the word tells us, moreover, come on, somebody. Moreover, of them is the servant warned. And verse 12 says, who can understand his error? Cleanse thou me from my secret faults. Keep back thy servants from what? From presumptuous, willful sins. Let them not have dominion or power or authority over my life. Them shall I be upright. Then shall I be upright and shall be innocent from the great transgression. You can thank God for that. That's enough to praise God for right there. Let the words of my mouth Whatever come through your mouth, don't let it be cursing and cussing.
Amen.
Don't let it be swearing and talking bad.
Amen.
Don't let it be mean spirit. Come on, somebody. Because you see what's going on in the land today, most people don't know. There's a, what they call a, there's an argumentative spirit. There's an attitude spirit, and there are symptoms of emotional dysfunction.
Amen.
Wait a minute. I'm going to get psychological here in a minute. I said argumentative spirit and an attitudinal spirit is a symptom of an emotional dysfunction.
Uh-huh.
Argument themselves are not all bad because they draw out hidden bitterness and resentment and other deficiencies that we need to work on. Oh, you don't have to say amen. I told you, I'm going to be your psychologist because every now and then a preacher can be a therapist if you're paying attention to it. I'm going to throw this in for free. Come on, somebody. You see, arguments are clear. And revelations are what is really, you see, arguments that are very clear of the revelations of what's really going on with us. When you're arguing and you got an argument spirit, that God is trying to reveal to us that something is going on with you. This ain't right. That ain't right, but I'm always right. Hey, I'm going to talk to you now. I'm trying to give you some emotional balance here. It's important that you get your thyroid checked, that your emotions don't get out of hand. Okay, all right. What is he saying? Emotionals are drawing out what already is there. You see, whatever your emotional dysfunction are, is already in you. That's why Jesus said, it ain't what goes in a man. I said, it ain't what goes in a man, but Jesus is what comes out. And the result of what comes out is an emotional dysfunction going on that took place a long time ago. And sometime, every now and then, somebody that did something that somebody else did to you, you didn't appreciate it, that emotion come out that you've been suppressing, I'm talking to you right now, that you've been holding back, it comes out in a way that gets you so angry, it turns into an argumentative spirit. And sometimes you can say something to somebody that can be close to you, and therefore it's going to call contention. And the scripture said contention between two brothers are like the bars of a castle. Look at somebody and say, what you always arguing about? Y'all ain't saying, yeah, argument about. What you arguing about? Always fussing and arguing about what? Because things don't go your way and you can't have your way. Things are not the way you like to have them. You have to give God that you got strength to be able to praise him. That you can go through every day and give God the praise. I'm talking to you this morning. I'm talking about is a mold, is a wrong mold. It's a defensive mold. Argumentative spirit is another mold that's been, the only way you can eradicate an argumentative spirit is that you got to take the high road or the low road.
Amen.
The high road is that either you're going to be a peacemaker or a peace breaker.
Amen.
Look at somebody and say, either you're a peacemaker. Are you a peacebreaker? Better known as a troublemaker. I don't know if they got that. I don't know if y'all got that. Y'all want that kind of therapy. You see, that's therapy. That's therapy because, you see, if I'm arguing all the time or there's an attitude of argumentative spirit, come on, somebody. You're going to see it in a minute because I'm getting ready to get into word right now. You're going to find out how important it is to have the right attitude. And the right attitude is the be attitude. And having the be attitude is going to make you a peacemaker and not a peace breaker, not a troublemaker. Because when you got that spirit down inside of you, you see, you can still be anointed and have an argumentative spirit. Oh, my. All right. Let me just show you what I mean. He says, let the words of my mouth. Mm-hmm. Everybody say, let the words.
Let the words
of my mouth. Let the words
of my mouth.
Not mama mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Not daddy mouth.
Mama.
Not brother, sister, or cousin, or the preacher, or the minister. Because, you know, I heard a sermon yesterday about hard-headed preachers.
Yeah.
I was a hard-headed preacher, too. Come on, somebody. And I still got a little hard-headed, but it's in the right hard-head. Because I'm going to do what God tells me to do. You see, being hard-headed is like a witchcraft spirit. How many were hard-headed? Raise your hand. Tell the truth in church. You ain't got never been hard-headed. You did everything God mama told you to do. You mean you ain't never been? Okay, all right. Cause you see, God, I'm going to have to talk to y'all. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. what's in my mouth and in my heart, what I meditate on, be, please, Lord, whatever I'm doing, let it be acceptable. Let it be recognizable in thy sight, O Lord, because you are my strength. And Lord, I thank you for being my redeemer. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in my sight, O Lord, my God and my redeemer. Now, I got to thinking about that preacher sermon yesterday, a hard-headed preacher. And I got to thinking about the prodigal son. But the word prodigal means one who is wasteful and one who is troubled and reckless. And I got to thinking about the prodigal son. And I drew the conclusion he was hard-headed even though he was living among luxury. I asked myself the question, what was he thinking when he said he wanted to leave? Come on, somebody. When you stop and think about how good you got it, some people think they can get it better. Come on, somebody. Think about he had 3 square meals a day. He had nice clothes. His father owed him part of the estate. He came from an upbringing. Come on, somebody. Well, y'all ain't with me right now. I brought you something. The upbringing was extremely important. Oh, the upbringing was extremely important. You see, it was important that we understand that when God is working on you, his mom and daddy weren't just anybody, but they trained him in a special way. Come on, somebody, read it for me. I said, do what? You see, he had an upbringing that was good, an upbringing that was decent. But somewhere along the way, he got dissatisfied. He wasn't happy with all that was going on. And so he found out, he began to think to himself, I see my friends at a party all night. They're going out with their other friends. Look like they got nicer clothes and nicer horses and everything. I'm always working and laboring. It look like we don't never have a good time around here. But I'm here to tell you, only Jesus can satisfy. Amen. But he began to think with himself, maybe he was missing something. Maybe I missed that fine girl. Or maybe I ain't been hanging out late. There was something missing, but the father stuck to the training. Amen. Come on, somebody. Train up a child. How you know you're training a child right? Because the train is on the right track. Are y'all with me on this? Sometimes I got to give you a pictorial so you can understand where I'm coming from. Train up a child. Now remember, when you train up a child in the way they should go, there come a time that they will go wayward and may go off in track. But because of the training that you have instilled within them, though they may go off a little bit, God's Holy Ghost got a way of bringing them back. You got to thank God for the Holy Ghost. You don't want to give him the praise. That's all right. I know where I'm going with this because I know how God operates in the spirit realm. You see, I thought about this prodigal son, and he was hard-headed. There's some hard-headed preachers, and there's some hard-headed members. There's some hard-headed folks on the choir, and there's some hard-headed folks on the usher board. God tell them one thing, and they want to do something else. Don't act like if you were hard-headed when it came to your mama and daddy, you're going to be hard-headed when it comes to coming God. You see, the prodigal son, something happened to him, and he got off the train. Are y'all with me on this? Now, I better step. I'm going to pass this around because, see, y'all looking at it, but I want you to see it for yourself. It's important that we understand there's a blessing when you remain in the trained way. There's a blessing when you remain faithful. And this prodigal son came to his daddy. You know the story. Dad, can you give me what's part of my estate, what belonged to me? Give me what's mine. You know, I'm going to get it anyway. And you see, it is understanding that when the father or mother or someone passed away, they heard and go to the oldest son according to Jewish teaching. But he thought he missed out on something. So he wanted what belonged to him. And you know the story. He went out thinking that he could live a righteous living. Oh, he can, as long as you got money and got things and you can share, you're going to have all kind of friends. Come on, somebody. People will come to you out of the woodwork. Family members and loved ones. Hey, cuz, what's happening? You coming in some money, some bonus money? Come on, somebody. You coming in with some time and money? Come on, somebody. You know, it's amazing when you retire, people know when you get your check. They can time you, come on, somebody, to a dime. They know you get it between the first and the fifth, and they're going to try to get to you on the second before you start spending. You don't have to say amen. I know where I'm going with this. I'm trying to tell you something, but only the Lord can satisfy. This man thought that he would find something that he was looking for. And sometimes God is trying to bless you, and you're out looking somewhere, and the blessing is already on you. Amen. Wait a minute. I ain't through with you yet. I ain't through with you yet. You see, many people don't understand that blessings, you see, having a place to go, having a place to go is home. Having someone to love is family. Amen. Having both of them is a blessing.
That's right.
Having both of them,
Amen.
You got a home to go to, that's a blessing.
Amen.
You got family, that's a blessing.
Amen.
You got both of them, that's a blessing.
Amen.
But sometimes people want to leave looking for something that ain't out there for them. Oh, you don't want to hear that. You see, the prodigal son was not only hard-headed, but he was stubborn, and he had his fortune in his hand, and he was living what they call the worldly good life. And then when his money started dwindling and started disappearing, his friends started disappearing. When his stomach started growling, he wanted to eat. Nobody could help him out. Because when you ain't got nothing, nobody don't want to be bothered with nothing. I think Billy Preston said nothing from nothing. Oh, y'all don't want to hear that, y'all. Billy Preston said nothing from nothing, Lee. And then he said, you got to have something. Well, Jesus got something if you want to be with him. I said, Jesus got something if you want to be with him. He can only satisfy you. Man can never satisfy you. The Bible says hell and destruction are never full. And men's eyes are never satisfied. That's why people look. They keep looking. They got, they want, and they want more. They ain't never satisfied with what they got. My God. This man was looking for something. Wine, women, gin, skin, and sin. He was looking for something. He thought he was missing out on something. He thought something was missing in his life. But when he went out, he missed the training.
Yes, he did.
Come on, somebody. I said he missed the train.
Yes, he did.
You ever miss something? A plane, boat, train, a car, a ride? A MBTA bus, somebody waiting on you, say, ain't got more time for him or her. I'll see them later. Let them catch the Uber or Lyft. Oh, y'all don't want to hear that kind of preacher. They will leave you. I'm going to preach the sermon on waiting and leaving. Because Jesus, when he comes, ain't no use to trying to pack something and think he's going to take it with you. Come on, somebody. He said, I'm going to come like a moment and a twinkling. It's going to happen so fast, you won't even know it took place.
Amen.
Thank you, baby. Thank you. Look at somebody and say, train up a child.
Train up a child.
In the way she should or he should go.
In the way she should go.
And when you train them, they'll never depart.
They won't.
See, the part that bother people when they say never depart, they don't think they won't stray from time and time again. But guess what? God got his eye on you. God had his eye on the prodigal son. God was watching him like an eagle was watching a hawk. Come on, somebody. I better still like an eagle or hawk were watching a chicken. Because he's going to keep his eye on that chicken to see if he's going to make any moves. What are you saying, Pastor? This man went out, lost everything his father gave him. Can you imagine messing up everything, all the stock and all the money and all the fortune, all the fine clothes and the ring and the watches and the robes and all the nice things that he possessed in his lifetime? He all wasted it away. And when he got out there, he went into a strange place in a strange language. Nobody didn't know him, so he figured he couldn't be recognized. Come on, somebody. You'd be surprised when you call yourself being slick on the down low, going out trying to party on a sly, and you're going to run into one of them so-called saints.
Amen.
What you doing here? No, what you doing here? Then y'all started saying, what you doing here? What you doing here? You see, both of y'all shouldn't be there, but come on, somebody. But both of y'all are there. Who playing a game with who? You see, God knows all things. But thank God for a trained child. Come on, somebody. Even a little child knows right and knows wrong. And when this man realized that I'm getting hungry now, and he began, you see, it was considered a curse to hang out or to feed the swine. Come on, somebody. You've heard this sermon before. You see, this man thought he was going to find something he was missing or find something he lost. And then he realized when he got out there and gave everything away, he was all alone. But the training kicked in. Look at somebody said the training kicked in. What training did he kick in? The training the way his mother and father raised him. And when the training kicked in, he said, I can't keep going on like this. There comes a time when you get sick or tired of being sick and tired. There comes a time when you're run down and wore out and you want a change in your life. You forgot how good you had it. And when you're in a miserable place, I want you to know only Jesus can satisfy. When you realize that the training you're getting through this ministry and through the raising of your parents, and realize only God, only Jesus can satisfy, the better your life is going to be.
Amen. Praise God.
Wait a minute. My mom and daddy weren't always right, but they was always on point. Come on, somebody. Why would your mom and daddy tell you something they done been through and done this and done that and can tell you something and you won't listen to them? You ain't got gray hair because you're dumb. You got gray hair because you're wise. Come on, somebody. The Bible says hoary head. Gray-headed. You got to have some wisdom. You ain't been through what you've been through in order to survive because God just allowed you to live. You got that gray because God allowed that gray to set the world know that you got some wisdom.
Amen.
I know some of y'all say, I know some gray-headed fools. They ain't as foolish as you think they is because they're still here.
That's true.
Come on, somebody. You know, we need to understand something. This prodigal son,
Amen.
Prodigal means just that, prodigal. Uh-huh. Reckless, wasteful.
Amen.
And there's some prodigal children, uh-huh. Prodigal husband and wife. In other words, he was a hard-headed child.
Yes, he was.
He was a hard-headed man.
Yes, he was.
Jonah was a hard-headed man. Saul was a hard, don't y'all get me started, was a hard-headed man. There's a whole lot of hard-headed preachers and people in the Bible. But because of the training of the Holy Ghost and the training of mom and daddy, they got trained in the right way. And they ran amok, they ran aground, and God finally got them back on the right track.
Amen.
You have to thank God he got you on the right track. Wait a minute. When he went through what he went through, and he tried all that he could, he realized this is not the way. I'm hanging out with the swines. I'm eating their husk. I know back home in my father's house. I know back home in my home church. There's some good preaching there. There's some good anointing there. There's some power in the midst. Sometimes we're going looking for something and it's already here. Sometimes we're searching for something and God has already provided for you. This prodigal son, the Bible said he came to his senses. You see, that when the training kicks in, you'll come to your senses and you'll realize, like Dorothy said, there's no place. Oh, you don't want to hear that. That prodigal son realized, why should I suffer when my father's servant can feed me and help me? I know what I'll do. First, I'll repent. I've sinned against my father, and I've sinned against God. He recognized the training. When we come to recognize and repent, God can change things. And then you begin to realize, I done tried everything, and only Jesus can satisfy. The Bible said when he come to realize what he done, he took off for home. Y'all ain't with me right now. Sometimes we think we're doing right when we're really doing wrong. Sometimes we think because when we speak, our mouth is a prayer book, and we can speak no wrong. But that argumentative spirit, come on somebody, or you might not be hoeing around, you might not be committing adultery, you might not be lying or cheating or killing or stealing, but you can have an argumentative spirit that can destroy the lives of others. Well, he's preaching about me. Look at somebody and say, he's preaching about you. Now, see, some of y'all going to get mad now because you're hard-headed. You don't want to hear the message. Come on, somebody. Everybody else is hard-headed but me. Come on, somebody. I want you to think about this message that God has trained you through his word, and you're on the right track. And he said, train up a child, train up an adult, train up a person in the way in which they will go. And when they begin to progress and get older and older, they can teach others because they know the way. Some of us are grown prodigal sons and prodigal daughters. Prodigal mothers and prodigal fathers. But we don't have to live an untrained life. The life of Christ is a disciplined life. The discipline of a disciple. Why is this so important? Why am I bringing it like this? Because God wanted us to see that when he finally realized within himself that he was short of what God wanted him to do, he took off for home. But you need to understand something. There was a lot going on when he left. Anytime you got a son or daughter, oh my God, you have no idea. When you raise seven children, come on somebody, when they're young, they're on your lap. But when they leave home, they'll own your heart. Oh, and they can do a number one job on you because you're wondering what they're up to and what's going on and if they're all right. And the father worried and looked over the hill day in and day out wondering where this wayward child has gone. Wondering if they took in the teachings. Wondering if they took in the training and the discipline of God's word. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Look at somebody and say, I hope you're getting this.
I hope you're getting this.
Train up a child in the way. What?
Amen.
Train up a child? But Lord, my pastor, you don't understand. I've been training that Negro. I'm sorry. I've been training him all my life. And they're hard-headed and they're thick as a brick. I just can't see. Just keep on training.
Yes. Right.
Don't get weary in well-doing.
Right.
When you get tired, reinforce yourself.
Right.
Reinforce the concrete thinking.
Yes.
Reinforce the word of God.
True.
Don't get tired. Don't get weary. Because one day they'll come back.
Come on,
oh, I know this from personal experiences.
Amen.
Oh, I remember I used to say things to my mom. Mm-hmm. My Lord, that people would cringe. But one day the Holy Ghost got a hold of me.
Amen.
Hey. I remember walking down the street, and all I could do was just cry and feel my tears. And I thought my mama was going to slap me upside the head, and all she did is put her arms around me. Sometimes all we got to do, we understand it.
Yes.
And all we got to do is just put our arms around our children and tell them that we love them.
Yes.
Forgiveness is a powerful thing. Look at somebody and say, forgiveness.
Forgiveness
is a powerful thing.
Amen.
Some of y'all understand how powerful it is. Instead of you prefer to take up the spirit of argument. Argue for what? Because you right? The way I look at it, train up a child, I got that in the back of my head.
Amen.
I said, I got train up a child in the back of my head.
That's right.
Okay. You'll understand it in a minute.
Amen.
Why is it so important? Because when the Father saw the Son come up over the hill, it's the same way that God saw you when you came up over your hill. When God saw you were wayward and lost and destructed. When God saw you out in the world on the edge of destruction. Come on, somebody. You think that bipolar and schizophrenia is a thing of the past? It's just as real today as it was when it first came on the scene by the Antichrist, by the spirits of unbelief. Why? Because of a hard-headed... See, Lucifer was hard-headed. He was in heaven, but he was hard-headed. He didn't get God's training. Are y'all getting with this, or y'all want to get with that? Come on, somebody. Make up your mind, because you got to make up your mind what you're going to do. Come on, somebody. You going to either tell them right, or you going to do something wrong. It's important that we understand that finally when the Father saw him, can you imagine you concerned? You see, we living in a time that the minute, I'm going to show you how programmed, how messed the enemy got attack our mind. The minute we hear ambulance, please call, we cringe. And you wonder, where's my child at? And you know, when I was a kid, Julia, coming along, after the 11 or 10 o'clock news, there was a line that came across the screen that said, it's 11 o'clock. Do you know where all your children at? Y'all don't remember that? Do y'all ever say amen? Come on. I came up a time where you told, don't let them lights catch you. Come on, somebody. And they didn't play. When they, and you know, this time of the year, right about now, they stay light until almost 9 o'clock. So we would play and play and play. But when it started getting dark, all the kids said, see you later. Amen. Where you going? You don't know my mama. You don't know my daddy. You know. And if you had one of them daddy that had a belt that was too long, and even if he pulled it around, the long part would hang down between his legs. And he didn't even have to pull it off. Nigga. Never mind. Y'all don't, I'm sorry. You don't want to hear that kind of preaching. See, that's the way I was brought up. And I kind of wish that my father had been a little hard on me, I would have been even a better man. I wish my mama had been a little hard on me, I would have been a better man. Come on, somebody. But you see, when that argumentative spirit, that hard-headed spirit showed up, it wanted to turn me out and called me to do things I had no business doing. Come on, somebody. But the God we serve is a good God. And then I realized, like the prodigal father's son, the son of the prodigal, he saw his son come up over the hill. The same way that God saw you come up over your hill. God spotted you a long time ago. And when God saw it, and when the father saw it, the Bible said he didn't wait till the son come, but he ran to meet him. When the last time you ran to meet your child? Because sometimes we get so grown, I'm grown, they need to come to me. I'm the oldest. They speak to me first. We so grown, we grown, our own grown stink. I didn't hear no amen. Because see what happened, you forgot your training. If you want children or young people to respect you, you got to earn their respect. If you're disrespectful to them, guess what they're going to be to you? Even with the training. Oh, it get real pitiful. Ain't some folks in the church real pitiful? That's true. True. The argument of spirit. The reason is an argument of spirit. There's a dysfunction that has gone down into your emotion, and that emotion comes out any time of the day or night, and you'll find out hard about something that ain't nobody worried about. When the father saw him, son, he said, bring out him. Bring him out a robe. Bring him out a ring. Bring him out some shoes. Kill the fatted calf. Oh, I'm happy now. Night after night, my heart ached. Night after night, I worried about my son. When I heard the noise in the street, when I heard the gunshot, when I heard the news, my heart went out. Who child is that?
Amen.
My God, my God.
Amen.
But when that child came up over the hill,
yes,
that rain with that prodigal son come up over the hill, the father rejoiced,
yes,
kill the father care.
Yes.
My son that was lost is now found.
Yes, sir.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
He's finally come home now.
Right.
And then you realize your training won't be in vain.
Right.
See, when you live a life,
yes,
when you live a life in vain,
mm-hmm,
it's hard living.
Yes. Come on now. Preach.
If you live a life in vain,
yes,
it's hard living.
Yes.
Living a vain life. You see it all the time in Hollywood.
True.
People are said to be something great or important.
Yes.
But what does that mean in the eyesight of God?
Yes.
But wait a minute. That would be the end of the story, but it ain't. While they was up to the house partying, my son that's at home, he's got a ring, he's got a robe, he was lost, but now he's found, we happy as a lark, we're jumping all around. But the old son was out there in the field working, heard the music and the partying, the drinking and the laughing, they're jumping up and down. And then something jumped on him, Minister Green.
Mm-hmm.
Bam!
Yeah.
An argumentative spirit.
Amen.
Am I right?
Yes.
Why? Because he caught an attitude.
That's right.
He asked one of the servants, what's going on? You mean to tell me you don't know what happened? That brother of yours that won't no good, won't up to no good, that everybody poked fun there, that took all the family had, went out and lived a good life, and did this and did that, lost it all, and came back. Your daddy gave him a ring, a watch, come on somebody, a robe and some shoes, and killed a fatty calf. And you can see the oldest brother saying, is that right? Uh-huh, you don't want to hear that kind of preaching, huh? Is that right? He got everything.
Mm-hmm.
Well, wait a minute. He got an attitude.
That's right.
Attitude. Argumentative spirit.
Amen.
It got down in him, and he had an emotional dysfunction.
Yes, he did.
So emotional, he wouldn't even go up to the house to celebrate. Same way that God people know somebody backslidden got saved,
uh-huh,
came back, and we want to hold up a track against them.
Uh-huh.
You have to thank God for the training up and the way in which they, and when they get old, they'll never. You know why? Because when you got a home, having a place to go home, or having someone to love as family,
yes,
and if you got them both,
yes,
you're a blessing.
Yes. Yes.
Look at somebody and say,
you're blessed.
Beyond measure.
Amen.
Go and measure that.
Amen.
What God has done for you already.
Yes.
And how he's provided for you,
yes,
already. Look what God has moved doors and moved windows,
yes,
and poured you out a blessing,
yes,
that you couldn't get on your own, but God provided for you.
Yes.
God opened up the windows for you.
Yes.
God opened up the doors for you.
Yes.
He held the devil back until you and I learned to grow in grace.
Yes.
Wait a minute. He got so mad, the daddy had to go out to him. Y'all know the story.
Yes.
Old dad went out there and said, boy, what's your problem?
Mm-hmm.
You know what's the matter with me.
Amen.
I hear that in the church all the time.
Amen.
You know what's the matter with me. I'm mad. Pastor didn't even call me and wish me nothing. I got to blame it on the pastor, you know, the pastor guy. Because he's the key person, you know, pointing all the fingers at. Pastor this and pastor that. Stay mad with the pastor for a week. I might come back to church. I'm upset with him. Upset with what? Think about it for a moment. Thank God you got a place to worship. Thank God you got a place that's anointed. Thank God you got somebody that will stand up. Oh, I had my battles. I had my fighting. I dealt with people who didn't like me. And when I took a stand, I didn't back down. And to this day, my name ain't because it is because I backed down. My name is because I stood up. Don't let it get twisted in your mind. Stand up for what is right. Stand up for what is just, because you've been trained the right way. I don't care what the world is doing. I don't care what law they're putting on the book. If God said it, it's going to come to pass.
Amen.
Look at somebody say, but I am motivated by love. See, love is a powerful motivation. If you do it for any other reason, people are going to figure it out and mock you. Come on, somebody. I love it when you do somebody say, well, wait a minute, what you doing this for? Mm-hmm. Come on, somebody. Like, oh, they turn sideways and they pull the pants. What you doing this for? Huh? They think you up to something. You ain't up to nothing. You're just trying to show a little love. Come on, somebody. Try sometime. You'd be surprised. Come on, somebody, talk to me now. Every now and then, you ought to go by the store and get a whole thing of ice cream and say, look, I was in the neighborhood. This is for you. Someone's going to say, you bought this for me? What you done put in this? What's wrong with this? Something wrong with this, you know. You got my favorite, too. This butter pecan, maple walnut, you bought that for me? And you dropping this off. See, I'm trying to tell you something. See, come on, somebody. Sometimes your enemy's enemy is your friend.
That's true.
Your enemy's enemy is your friend. Oh, never mind, never mind. Never. You know who your enemy are. Because David said, I could deal with this thing if I knew it was my enemy. I can deal with the issue because I know where my enemy is coming from. But it was a friend of mine. It was an acquaintance of mine. One that sit down with me. One that went to church with me. One that praised God with me. One that sung with me. I couldn't understand why could this happen to me. Oh, you don't want to hear that kind of preaching. Because I learned early on, you can try this and you can try that.
Amen.
But I learned only Jesus can satisfy.
Right.
Look at somebody and say, only Jesus
can
satisfy. All right now.
This is Pastor Watkins from Community Revival and Outreach Ministries. I trust that you enjoyed that wonderful service we just had. And I trust the Lord that it touched your heart and your spirit. And it also inspired your soul. But beyond just listening to a message, we also ask you to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And how you do that, you just simply ask and bow before Christ. And if you're willing to lay hands upon your TV or bow your heads right where you are or sitting, if you just bow your head with me and we'll pray the prayer of faith. Heavenly Father, we truly thank you for all things in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that you forgive us of all our sins and have mercy upon our soul. And that not only you save us, O Lord, from our sins, but, O Lord, that you would sanctify our hearts and sanctify our souls, as well as, O Lord, baptize us with the Holy Ghost and that with fire. We accept you, O Lord, into our hearts and our life. We confess our sins and we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that God raised him from the dead. And by believing and accepting this, O Lord, we claim to be saved in his holy name. We give thanks and praise for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I trust the Lord that your heart is fixed with the Lord and that your blessing will be assured and that you'll come out and fellowship with us. And if not with us, your own local church in your area, and that God will be a blessing to you until we see you again. Take care and God bless. Bye-bye.